Member for Caribou Chilcotin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Gold Rush Trail. Back in 1850, explorers to Haida Gwaii found gold. In 1854, more was found on the Columbia River, just south of trail. People came to BC from all over the world, including Scotland, England, Germany, and even 6,000 to 7,000 immigrants from China. Many Chinese immigrants moved to the Caribou to become miners or set up businesses such as laundries and restaurants in a place called Barkerville. The Gold Rush started in 1860 and was centered in Barkerville. In response to the Caribou Gold Rush, Governor James Douglas built at great expense a 650-kilometer road from Yale into the rugged interior of the Caribou Mountains. This provided an important transportation route for further development of the mainland colony. By 1865, the surface placer gold was almost gone. Barkerville was practically wiped out by a fire in 1868. And in 1858, Governor James Douglas recruited 500 miners to be fed in exchange for free labor building the first portion of the trail. So what is the Gold Rush Trail today? The Gold Rush Trail is the highway from Hope to Barkerville. And another part of the Gold Rush Trail is a trail from 70 Mile House presently to Horsefly and on to Barkerville. This trail was established back in the 1990s, and it was registered as a legal snowmobile trail in 1999 by the 100 Mile Trails Foundation and by the BC Snowmobile Federation. It will eventually be a 463-kilometer Gold Rush snowmobile trail linking communities, Clinton, 70 Mile, 100 Mile, Likely, and Wells, to promote the Caribou as a winter destination for snowmobile touring. And this is a gold rush. This is a gold rush for our communities, for tourism, for our communities, for their social well-being. And it draws so much attention and dollars and cents and recreation to the Caribou. This trail has had many, many, many volunteer hours put into it. It also has the participation of the provincial government, the federal government, the 100 Mile Trails Foundation, the 100 Mile Snowmobile Club, the First Nations, who work very closely with all these organizations, encouraging and working together for the Gold Rush economic venture. The trail also has great participation from New Pathways to Gold, a society that was formed in about 2005, which works to promote our heritage from Hope to Barkerville, along the highway and along our trails. This venture can only be said that our government has given probably over $2 million, time and energy through our staff, and participation with all those who were involved in putting such a great venture together. Our partners are Clinton, 70 Mile House, 100 Mile House, Horsefly, Likely, Barkerville, Wells. Our First Nations partners are Canoe and Dog Creek, Canham Lake, Alkali, snowmobile clubs throughout the region, the Green Lake Snowmobile Club, the 100 Mile House Snowmobile Club, Interlake Snowmobile Club, Williams Lake Powder Kings, and the British Columbia Snowmobile Federation. Our tourist associations throughout many regions are involved. The South Caribou Tourism Center, Caribou Chilcotin Coast Tourist Association, the Vancouver Coast Mountains Tourist Region, Thompson Okanagan Tourist Association, Aboriginal Tourism BC, and Heritage Tourism Alliance. We have not-for-profit organizations. This here is an economic gold rush, an economic gold rush for the people of the caribou, the people for the province, and it's also a gold rush for the environment. When you have trails that are maintained, that are built to the highest environmental standards, we know that that is so important to the province of British Columbia. And part of our trail system is our First Nations heritage. They are great partners in this project. And so there's many types of gold rushes out there, but this one here is special, this one is unique, and this one will be there for history as it was when the gold rush first started back in the 1800s. Mr. Speaker, this is an opportunity that we must carry on. Someday, we hope that this trail will carry us through, right through British Columbia, with opportunities that keep moving our province ahead, with opportunities for First Nations, for young people, for those that enjoy the outdoors, and that for those that know what the economic benefits are to our small rural communities in British Columbia. Mr. Speaker, this here is called Gold Rush 2000, and it will carry on for many, many years. Thank you.
Member for Kootenay West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm pleased to respond to the member from Caribou, Chilcotin. She reminds me of a quote from our Lieutenant Governor, Judith Gajon, when she said, "They came for the gold, but stayed for the grass." And she is, of course, referring to what I'd call the gold rush of ranching in the Caribou country, which is still here today, as long as all the land isn't lost to development or sales to foreign companies to plant trees for carbon sequestration, taking the land out of agriculture production for hundreds of years. Or another business in the Caribou that has taken off would be that of ecotourism activities. I'd like to refer to Gary and Peggy Zorn. Both third-generation Western Canadians have over 30 years of knowledge and experience in the tourism industry with their company, EcoTours BC. They offer professional guide service with an excellent reputation for providing a quality wilderness outdoor experience, a sense of stewardship and regard for the waters and lands, and commitment to combining both good management with maintenance and enhancement of the unique ecosystem and life it sustains with their leave-only footprints philosophy ensures will be maintained for future generations. The lodge is located on the Quesnel River at the outlet of Quesnel Lake and at the foot of the Caribou Mountains in Likely. They offer a number of professionally guided outdoor all-inclusive adventure tours. Walking with the bears is one of those packages. This thrilling adventure has you walking among the bears in the boreal forest and on the riverbanks of the salmon-infested waters. It's high adventure where only a few people have had this rare opportunity to actually walk among the bears, including grizzly bears. And Gary has an international reputation as the bear whisperer. Because of his passion for the big bears and the knowledge of their habitat, habits, and body language, and his understanding of their actions and reactions. Gary is noted not only for his unique relationship with the bears, but also his many amazing bear, wildlife, and adventure stories. This company, along with the many others in BC, generate millions of dollars to the economy of our province. A short-lived gold rush? I think not. I believe these companies will be around for years to come as long as there are environmental regulations in place to ensure we continue to actually have the wildlife to watch. I also want to touch on another part of our province that experienced the gold rush as well, and that's in the Kootenays. First discovered by two prospectors from the nearby Dewdney Trail, the Leroy Mine was a claim that started the gold rush in Rosalind in 1890. It was sold to Colonel Topping in lieu of $12.50, and he then turned it around and sold it to a Spokane company for $30,000, a lot of money in those days. They began to develop the mine, and the town of Rosalind was born. In 1898, the Leroy Mine was sold to the British American Corporation for just over $3 million. Once the mine came into production, Leroy's stock jumped from 50 cents a share to $40 almost overnight. The population of Rosalind exploded as gold fever attracted men from around the world, and Rosalind became one of the largest cities in Western Canada and a major business center in North America. Many of the Rosalind mines became world famous and were worked over the next 40 years. By 1897, the population of Rosalind had increased to 7,000 with 42 saloons, 4 banks, and 17 law firms. And then we see the community of Trail was evolved from that. I also want to talk about the fact that the Golden City now looks to a new future, and that's the white gold of their winter ski slopes and the reawakening of their historic mines. So I think that it's a golden pass with historic buildings and sites, a really great museum, heritage sites, And it shows the importance that this community has given to the development of the Kootenays and the province. And another area was the Slocan Valley that saw considerable mining in the early 1800s. Millions of dollars came out of that area as well. In the community of Sandon actually had millions and millions of dollars come out of that tiny little community. And today it has some of the oldest trails in the region and in the province. Some of the trails, the railway was taken out and is now trails that one of the most actively used trails in all of BC is the Slocan Valley Trail that used to be a railway but now is a trail. It is utilized in the winter and the summer and is one of the most actively used trails in the province. From 1895 to 1910, there was over $12.5 million that came out of that valley, which would be equivalent to over $200 million today. So I think in response from the member of Caribou Chilcotin, we have a number of gold rush opportunities in our past, as well as new ones like ecotourism, that we need to ensure stay here for today and future generations, and we need to ensure that we have legislation and regulations in place to guarantee that that actually happens. And I think it's interesting to note that for people who are truly interested in gold rush and in BC and the role that the gold rush played in the world, they shouldn't miss the exhibit that's happening right now at the Royal BC Museum. It's called Gold Rush, El Dorado of BC, and it's here until October 31st. And it shows the excellent opportunities that gold rush provided for this province. Thank you,
ma'am. Member for Caribou Chilcotin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to my colleague across the floor. I was very happy to hear her be so positive about the wonderful things that the province has in British Columbia and the opportunities that we have, and as a government that we're working to make them even better by cooperating with citizens. We talk about ecotourism. Ecotourism is wonderful. It is a great product, and the people that she spoke about, I actually talked to them last week, and they're moving forward. There always is challenges, but you know, if you take a challenge and you quit looking at it as a negative and you make an opportunity out of it, Mr. Speaker, we move forward as we do in this government and as we do in my communities throughout the Caribou Chilcotin and all communities in British Columbia. And we talk about agriculture, the opportunities for agriculture, and the negative comments that came from across the floor regarding tree planting. I think that basically we should look at our statistics, we should look at the whole story, and not have sensationalism. Let's stick to truth and facts. And you know, Mr. I know lots about it. Mr. Speaker, working together with our landowners, with our communities, with our opportunities in this province, everything is a gold rush, not just trails, mining, forestry, agriculture, tourism, education, healthcare. This is a province full of gold rush. This is a province full of opportunities. This is a province with a government that looks forward to creating more opportunities. But back to my gold rush trail in the Caribou, Mr. Speaker, that I started my topic on, and I kind of got off because of some comments that were made. I encourage everyone to come in the wintertime, to come and see what we have, to see what our communities have put together with help from government, with help from different organizations, with First Nations, with people that see working together on the positive side of the equation, as we do on this side of the house, can bring nothing but more and more gold rushes to the province of British Columbia, to keep our environment safe by having trails that are met to the highest environmental standards possible in this province. Mr. Speaker, we have so much to be thankful for. We have so much to work for to make our opportunities and our province better, to help people with a hand up instead of a hand out. Mr. Speaker, this is a wonderful province. The Caribou Chilcotin is the best place on earth to live, and our gold rush will continue on for years and years to come, and I am so pleased to be a part of it. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Ms. Quaymall-Royal-Rhodes.
Thank you very much, Honourable Speaker. And this morning I'd like to stand up and talk here about affordability for seniors, because in fact, Affordability is a growing threat for many seniors in this province. And in a very timely way, there was a report that came out last week from the BC Seniors Advocate that actually highlights very specifically in great detail what that kind of affordability challenge looks like. But, you know, Honourable Speaker, for seniors who spent their entire life building the province of British Columbia and working at a variety of careers, many had had modest pensions that came out of that. Many more have, of course, had to rely on Canada Pension and an old age supplement, guaranteed income supplement to top that up. And the reality is, Honourable Speaker, that lots of seniors looked at their pension and looked at the kind of income that they might expect in their senior years and thought, this looks like it will be adequate. This looks like this will give us a reasonably secure future, and that we should be able to afford to have, you know, a kind of risk-free and anxiety-free retirement. But the reality is, Honourable Speaker, that that has not happened, and nowhere is that more vivid than here in British Columbia. And the challenge for affordability. So many seniors are now finding themselves stretched from 1 month to the next. And the report that came out from BC Seniors Advocate last week really highlights one aspect of that. And some of the details in there I will talk about shortly. But I think the reality is, Honourable Speaker, that one of the main challenges that seniors see is that the cost of living is outstripping their pension, their fixed pension, because remember that seniors are not in a position where they are going to see a significant growth in their pensions over time. They are not like the working person who can certainly get ahead and can get increases in pay or can advance their career or can move up in their companies. Seniors are in a position where their income is fixed and there will be no change to that. And in fact, the cost of living has outstripped any meager increases in seniors' pension growth for some time. This government has chosen a couple of things that they are now putting onto seniors' shoulders that are making things even less affordable for them. And I hear from seniors every day right across British Columbia about this growing anxiety and concern about the fees and costs that government has put on their shoulders. Now, we've canvassed in this legislature many times that the government has chosen in the most recent budget to give a considerable tax break to the wealthiest in the province, and at the same time, increase costs on families and on seniors. And it is more hard felt even than on families is a senior on a fixed income who is now looking at dramatic increases in their hydro bills, their MSP, their ICBC, and of course we've canvassed numerous times increased costs for ferries, for seniors who are now becoming more isolated and feeling less connected with their families as a result of those. But the growing cost around things like hydro and MSP and ICBC are a real crush for seniors who, again, on a fixed income, have no alternatives as to where they might find that money or how it might affect their well-being. So in fact, seniors right across British Columbia are struggling. They are having a very difficult time, and there are subsets of those, Honourable Speaker, that I'm going to speak about as well this morning. But many seniors, regardless of whether the government likes to believe that this is not true, many seniors are in a position of having to make some really hard choices. As they see their hydro bills going up, lots of seniors are trying to decide, do I turn the heat on during the winter in my home? Can I afford medication? Can I afford food? Which of these do I begin to cut back on as I see hydro rates increase, as I see MSP squeezing my meager income, as I see the cost of maybe trying to continue driving my car become more and more expensive, so they're having to make hard choices. These seniors who worked their entire lives to build British Columbia are now finding themselves in their senior years being squeezed and ignored and cornered by their own government. The Shelter Aid for Elderly Renters, which is a program that the government has put in place to help offset some of these costs, the Seniors Advocate has, in her report, outlined how incredibly inadequate it is in real terms. The fees and the top end of the SAFER program is completely inadequate to meet the real costs for seniors living in communities. The Seniors Advocate report has outlined very clearly that it is more expensive now for seniors if they don't own their own home, And that's a very different set of criteria that affect those. Seniors who are living in their own homes, who are having to be concerned about maintenance costs, upkeep costs. How do they maintain living in their home when these costs are beyond their means? Seniors who are living in rental accommodation, where even in places like Fort St. John, the rental costs are extremely high because of the pressures on the market. How do they continue to stay there when even the government's own aid program does not help them? Within this, Honourable Speaker, there's another subset of seniors who are even less able to cope with all of this, and that is women. Senior women, Honourable Speaker, within this, this subset of seniors, often did not work in the workplace to the same degree in the past, don't have a huge Canada pension, and are living on even lower incomes. If you're a First Nations woman, that is even lower. It's a very meager income. If you're an immigrant woman who is living now on your own, you've lost a spouse, you are finding that your income is completely inadequate. And so we see this threat for a huge number of seniors about encroaching homelessness. And there is no bigger fear, I think, for seniors than they might find themselves homeless at the end of their days. So the advocate has floated some interesting public policy ideas, and I'm sure we're going to touch on those today. You know, the government often likes to talk about the big jobs plan as somehow a panacea and a cure for all ailments, but certainly that doesn't help seniors at all. It is a completely inadequate response to them. So I think, Honourable Speaker, the fact that there are no clear answers coming from government, what are they going to do? You know, what can be done to make housing less affordable, to keep seniors in their homes as long as possible, to help them with this growing issue of affordability? And I'm looking forward to hearing what the government has to say on some of this. Thank you.
Member for Maple Ridge, Pitt Meadows.
Honourable Speaker, I'd like to thank the member from Esquimalt Railroads for bringing forward the motion entitled Affordability for Seniors. As the member noted, on May 21st, the Seniors Advocate for British Columbia, Isabel McKenzie, issued a report entitled Seniors Housing in BC. According to the report, the Seniors Advocate met with thousands of seniors and their families in every region of the province. Among the many issues and concerns raised, they expressed a deep concern about the affordability, availability, and the appropriateness of seniors housing in this province. Seniors expressed clearly that they want to age as independently as possible in their own homes and in their own local communities. As you know, Honourable Speaker, British Columbia was the first province in the country to establish the office of the Seniors Advocate. Naturally, the government takes the findings of this report very seriously. It is a thorough examination of housing for seniors as they age, and it examines how we can improve care and support our growing, aging population. In response, the Minister of Health issued a statement that agrees with many of the general findings of this report. The Minister is assuring British Columbians that the government will act on the majority of recommendations that pertain to the Ministry of Health. In the coming months, the recommendations will be further analyzed by government along with our health authorities and partners. Adopting many of the recommendations will require extensive work, coordination, and significant financial commitment. It is a fact, Honourable Speaker, that British Columbia has the fastest growth for seniors in Canada. It is expected to account for one quarter of our provincial population when it peaks in 2031. It is also a fact that British Columbians are living longer and better than any other province in Confederation. With that in mind, our government has invested over $4 billion to provide affordable housing for low-income individuals, seniors, and families since 2001. Each year, we spend over $2.7 billion on home and community care alone. This is up over 73% since 2001. We also provide support to more than 51,000 seniors' households across British Columbia through a range of housing options. In addition, we support senior homeowners through property tax deferment, the homeowner grant, home adaptations for independence, HAFI, and the BC Seniors Home Renovation Program. The government has also provided $22 million in funding to enhance and support the Better at Home program, which now operates in over 60 communities throughout BC. Better at Home provides improved access to non-medical supports such as light housekeeping, and transportation to appointments to help seniors remain in their homes and connected to their communities. In conclusion, Honourable Speaker, the government will act on the majority of recommendations contained in the Seniors Advocate Report. Our aim is to ensure the best quality of life and care for our seniors. Thank you.
Member for Esquimalt Royal Roads.
Thank you very much, Honourable Speaker, and thank you very much to the member for the response. I think it's interesting that the government is always very quick to respond to many of these critical reports that come out and demonstrate some of the failings that the government has put in place for either children and families or, in this case, seniors. They're very quick to come out and agree with all the findings. And so it's great to say that, but I think, in fact, history and examples of exactly the follow-through on this will prove that the government is often very slow to respond in real terms to some of these issues. The idea that we're going to analyze this, yes, certainly I think that that's all very laudable, but at the end of the day, seniors are in trouble right now in their current living circumstances. Many women are challenged with trying to make it from 1 month to the next. Seniors everywhere are very concerned about what will happen next winter when the hydro rates go higher, and how do they keep the heat on, and how do they afford medication, and do they have to make choices between eating less? So it's a great concern to me that the government will be quick to respond and say, wow, these are all great recommendations in this report and others, but what will the follow-through look like? I don't know, Honourable Speaker. I'm skeptical of the reality. The member opposite mentioned a couple of programs like the SAFER program, but the reality is that that program is highly undersubscribed. I mean, there's only 20% of seniors that are eligible are in fact subscribing to that, when there could be a whole lot more seniors that should be accessing that. So I think that needs to be publicized a lot more. The renovation programs all sound terrific. If you have the money to do that, if you have the money to make renovations and then to access the funds there, if you have no money and you're living on a well below the poverty level income, how in the world can you think about renovating your home? I mean, the government has made very clear choices here in, you know, big tax breaks for the wealthy, while those that built this province continue to live in hardship. And so I'd like to see more real action, a more real commitment by this government on how they're going to reach out to seniors today. Come the end of this summer, seniors once again are going to be concerned about how they are going to be able to continue to drive, how they're going to heat their house, how they're going to pay for their medical premiums, are they going to be able to afford their medication, do they have to keep the heat turned down low and wear more sweaters in their homes. I mean, we know that the implications of that are significant on the maintenance and upkeep of wherever they're living. These are hard choices that seniors are making. And the fact that the seniors advocate is outlined very clearly here, the hardship that is currently facing many individuals. On an $18,000 a year income, just the basic costs of getting through your life, whether it's paying your rent or anything, leaves seniors with anywhere from a $400 to $500 shortfall every single month. Honourable Speaker, that's inadequate. The government needs to do better, and they need to do it now. Thank you.
Thank you, Member.